Well, we were looking for 40 acres, and we found this farm under 4 feet of snow, and it wasn't an active farm at the time. No one had lived here for 20 years, so we were fell madly in love with it, just seeing it under 4 feet of snow on a beautiful, sunny winter day, and found out 2 days later that it was for sale, and that it was 440 acres instead of 40 acres, and we bought it. I'm Suzanne Willow.
And I'm Lanita Witt.
And together we own Willow Witt Ranch. And we've been here since 1985. We're an off-the-grid ranch, small farm, small ranch, big property, 445 acres, mostly forest, out of Ashland, Oregon. When we were first here, we used, the house had never had any electricity, did have running water from a small spring up above the house. And we looked at getting a phone line in, and in 1985 that was about $150,000, of course, and without electricity. And the first few years we just used kerosene lights. I had an old panel. I'd lived off grid before, so I had an old solar panel, and we used that when we did get a radio phone. That was just enough to run a 12-volt radio phone. And then we gradually started going into some active solar.
And that was our first solar panel array, and it was behind a hill that blocked the sun. So then we built a greenhouse woodshed chicken house that's about 30 feet from the house, had better solar gain, and now we're on our third machination of it with the solar panels that are behind us, and that's been there for probably 15 years now, I think.
Yeah, 12 or 15 something.
In 1996, we were able to tap into an artesian spring that's on the far side of the land. It's actually 4,000 feet from here because that's how much pipe it took to get the water from there to here. But it's a very pure water source, and we have water rights to that. And we put a Pelton wheel on that, so we have a trickle charge of electricity, which is really helpful in the winter when solar gain for the house is low. It backs up our solar system.
And because we're totally off-grid and we have no intertie with the grid electricity whatsoever, we have to have a generator backup for each one of our systems. So we have a gas Honda, nice quiet gas generator for the system at our house, the system at our rental Meadow House, and then we have a diesel on-demand generator that's noisier, but much farther away for the commercial system. And that has worked well, and they really pretty much come on when we need them. And we're very, very aware of the electricity. We're always just, in the morning, first thing we do is check the electricity. See if the generator needs to come on. At night, we make sure that we have enough electricity before we go to bed. Certainly laundry, we joke that other people make hay when the sun shines. We do laundry when the sun shines instead. And that's really has worked well for us. So in the winter, we put off laundry if we can until sunny days. And we try to, in the summer, we hang everything out on the line. In the winter, we do have to use a propane dryer. And so it's really worked well for us.
Feels very 21st century. I hope that's
the one. What century are we at?
Yeah, 21st.
21st,
okay.
Yeah.
And people who come here, you know, wouldn't realize that we're off grid if we didn't tell them about it.
Internet is by satellite.
And cell service is non-existent.
Yes. We have alpine dairy goats, and we raise the babies for pack animals. We learn to milk a goat with a pan, a flashlight, and a book. And we have chickens, we have 4 guard geese, and we have 9 decorative entertaining ducks. Built a bed and breakfast on the back of the house when we remodeled it, thinking that why do we have this acreage, and it's in order to bring people here. We've always had a vegetable garden.
Had some goat meat that needed to be eaten, so we made sausage with that. And we started going to the growers market. And so we've evolved into selling both goat and pork sausages, goat meat and pork meat, and then selling a lot of vegetables at the growers market. That's become almost half of our sales at this point, as our vegetable production has grown.
I would love with the education to have young people come up and be able to spend time learning about forest resilience, wetland restoration, where cows should be and where they shouldn't be, where our water comes from on a watershed, as well as all the alternative power. It's a micro ecological experiment, adventure with a lot to offer.
My hope for this land is that we leave it. We're starting a nonprofit, so we would like to leave the land as a demonstration of small farming and very small-scale farming, and also a demonstration of forest and wetland restoration, and an example of how to take care of land and see what it needs and really pay attention to that.
I think the environmental impact of a farm on land can be difficult, and animals can be difficult, and over the years we've learned how to make less of an impact and actually make some benefit with it, and incorporating pollinators and stream buffers from our animals that accomplish those needs. So we've learned a lot over the years, and we'd like to share that with the future generations.